हरे कृष्णा। सो टुडे वी आर रीडिंग टेक्स्ट 2। अत्याहार प्रयासश्च प्रजल्पो नियम आग्रह जनसंगश्च लौल्यम च षड्भिर् भक्तिर् विनश्यति। वन्स डिवोशनल सर्विस इज स्पॉइल्ड व्हेन ही बिकम्स टू एंटैंगल्ड इन द फॉलोइंग 6 एक्टिविटीज। 1. ईटिंग मोर देन नेसेसरी और कलेक्टिंग मोर फंड्स देन रिक्वायर्ड। 2. ओवर एंडेवरिंग फॉर मंडेन थिंग्स दैट आर वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू ऑब्टेन। 3. टॉकिंग अननेसेसरली अबाउट मंडेन सब्जेक्ट मैटर्स। 4. प्रैक्टिसिंग द स्क्रिप्चुरल रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशंस ओनली फॉर द सेक ऑफ फॉलोइंग देम एंड नॉट फॉर द सेक ऑफ स्पिरिचुअल एडवांसमेंट और रिजेक्टिंग द रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशंस ऑफ द स्क्रिप्चर्स एंड वर्किंग इंडिपेंडेंटली और विम्सिकली। 5. Associating with worldly minded persons who are not interested in Krishna consciousness, and 6. Being greedy for mundane achievements. Atyahara prayasascha prajalpo niyamagraha janasangascha laulyamcha shadbir bhaktir vinashyati. Human life is meant for plain living and high thinking. Since all conditioned living beings are under the control of the Lord's third energy, this material world is designed so that one is obliged to work. The Supreme Personality of Godhead has three primary energies or potencies. The first is called the Antaranga Shakti or the internal potency. The second is called the Tathastha Shakti or the marginal potency. The third is called Bahiranga Shakti or the external potency. The living entities constitute the marginal potency and they are situated between the internal and external potencies. Being subordinate as eternal servants of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Jivatmas or atomic living entities must remain under the control of either the internal or external potency. When they are under the control of the internal potency, they display their natural constitutional activity, namely constant engagement in the devotional service of the Lord. This is stated in the Bhagavad Gita 9.13. Mahatmanas tu mam partham devam prakritim ashritaha bhajanti ananya manaso dnyatva bhutadim avyayam. O son of Pritha, those who are deluded, the great souls are under the protection of the divine nature. They are fully engaged in devotional service because they know me as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, original and inexhaustible. The word Mahatma refers to those who are broad-minded, not cripple-minded. Cripple-minded persons always engaged in satisfying their senses, sometimes expand their activities in order to do good for others through some ism like nationalism, humanitarianism and altruism. They may reject personal sense gratification for the sense gratification of others like the members of their family, community or society, either national or international. Actually, all these activities are extended sense gratifications from personal to communal to social. These activities may all be very good from the material point of view, but they have no spiritual value. The basis of such activities is sense gratification, either personal or extended. Only when a person gratifies the senses of the Supreme Lord can he be called a Mahatma or a broad-minded person. In the above quoted verse from Bhagavad Gita, the words Daivim Prakritim refer to the control of the internal potency or pleasure potency of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. This pleasure potency is manifested as Srimati Radharani or her expansion Lakshmi, the goddess of fortune. When the individual jiva souls are under the control of the internal energy, their only engagement is the satisfaction of Krishna or Vishnu. This is the position of a Mahatma. If one is not a Mahatma, he is Duratma or cripple-minded person. Such mentally crippled Duratmas are put under the control of the Lord's external potency, Mahamaya. Indeed, all living entities within this material world are under the control of Mahamaya, whose business is to subject them to the influence of threefold miseries, Adidaivak Klesha, sufferings caused by the demigods such as droughts, earthquakes and storms. Adibhautika Klesha, sufferings caused by other living entities like insects or animals. And Adhyatmik Klesha, suffering caused by one's own body and mind such as physical and mental infirmities. Daiva Bhutatma Hetava, the conditioned soul subjected to these three miseries by the control of the external energy suffer various difficulties. The main problem confronting the conditioned souls is the repetition of birth, old age, disease and death. In the material world, one has to work for the maintenance of the body and soul. But how can one perform such work in a way that is favorable for the execution of Krishna consciousness? Everyone requires possessions such as food, grains, clothing, money and other things necessary for the maintenance of the body. But one should not collect more than necessary for his actual basic needs. If this natural principle is followed, there will be no difficulty in maintaining the body. According to nature's arrangement, living entities lower on the evolutionary scale do not eat or collect more than necessary. Consequently, in the animal kingdom, there is generally no economic problem or scarcity of necessities. If a bag of rice is placed in a public place, birds will come to eat a few grains and go away. A human being, however, will take away the whole bag. He will eat all his stomach can hold and then try to keep the rest in storage. According to scriptures, this collecting of more than necessary atyahara is prohibited. Now the entire world is suffering because of it. Collecting and eating more than necessary also causes prayasa or unnecessary endeavor. By God's arrangement, anyone in any part of the world can live peacefully if he has some land and milk cow. There is no need for man to move from one place to another to earn a livelihood, for one can produce food grains locally and get milk from cows. That can solve all economic problems. Fortunately, man has been given higher intelligence for the cultivation of Krishna consciousness or the understanding of God, one's relationship with Him, and the ultimate goal of life, love of God. Unfortunately, so-called civilized man, not caring for God realization, utilizes his intelligence for getting more than necessary and simply eat to satisfy the thirst. By God's arrangement, there is sufficient scope for the production of milk and grains for human beings all over the world. But instead of using his higher intelligence to cultivate God consciousness, so-called intelligent men misuse their intelligence to produce many unnecessary and unwanted things. Thus, factories, slaughterhouses, brothels and liquor shops are open. If people are advised not to collect too many goods, eat too much or work unnecessarily to possess artificial amenities, they think they are being advised to return to a primitive way of life. Generally, people do not like to accept plain living and high thinking. That is their unfortunate position. Human life is meant for God realization, and the human being is given higher intelligence for this purpose. Those who believe that this higher intelligence is meant to attain a higher state should follow the instructions of the Vedic literatures. By taking such instructions from higher authorities, one can actually become situated in perfect knowledge and give real meaning to life. In Srimad Bhagavatam 1.2.9, Sri Suta Goswami describes the proper human dharma in this way. Dharmasya hi apavargasya nartho arthayopakalpate narthasya dharma kantasya kamo labhaya hi smarataha. All occupational engagements dharma are certainly meant for ultimate liberation. They should never be performed for material gain. Furthermore, one who is engaged in the ultimate occupational service dharma should never use material gain to cultivate sense gratification. The first step in human civilization consists of occupational engagements performed according to the scriptural injunctions. The higher intelligence of a human being should be trained to understand basic dharma. In human society, there are various religious conceptions characterized as Hindu, Christian, Hebrew, Mohammedan, Buddhist and so on, for without religion, human society is no better than animal society. As stated above, dharmasya hi apavargasya nartho arthopokalpate, Srimad Bhagavatam 1.2.9, religion is meant for attaining emancipation, not for getting bread. Sometimes human society manufactures a system of so-called religion aimed at material advancement, but that is far from the purpose of true dharma. Religion entails understanding the laws of God, because the proper execution of these laws ultimately leads one out of material engagement. That is the true purpose of religion. Unfortunately, people accept religion for material prosperity because of atyahara or an excessive desire for such prosperity. True religion, however, instructs people to be satisfied with the bare necessities of life while cultivating Krishna consciousness. Even though we require economic development, true religion allows it only for supplying the bare necessities of material existence. Jivasya tattva jidnyasa, the real purpose of life is to inquire about the absolute truth. If our endeavor prayasa is not to inquire about the absolute truth, we'll simply increase our endeavor to satisfy our artificial needs. A spiritual aspirant should avoid mundane endeavor. Another impediment is prajalpa, unnecessary talking. When we mix with a few friends, we immediately begin unnecessary talking, sounding just like croaking toads. If you must talk, we should talk about the Krishna consciousness movement. Those outside of the Krishna consciousness movement are instead interested in reading heaps of newspapers, magazines and novels, solving crossword puzzles and doing many other nonsensical things. In this fashion, people simply waste their valuable time and energy. In the Western countries, old men retired from active life play cards, fish, watch television and debate about useless socio-political schemes. All these and other frivolous activities are included in the prajalpa category. Intelligent persons interested in Krishna consciousness should never take part in such activities. Jana Sangha refers to associating with persons not interested in Krishna consciousness. One should strictly avoid such association. Srila Narottam Das Thakur has therefore advised us to live only in the association of Krishna conscious devotees, Bhakta Sanevasa. One should always engage in the service of the Lord in the association of Lord's devotees. Association with those engaged in a similar line of business is very conducive to advancements in that business. Consequently, materialistic persons from various associations and clubs to enhance their endeavors. For example, in the business world, we find such institutions as the Stock Exchange and Chamber of Commerce. Similarly, we have established the International Society for Krishna Consciousness to give people an opportunity to associate with those who have not forgotten Krishna. This spiritual association offered by our ISKCON movement is increasing day by day. Many people from different parts of the world are joining this society to awaken their dormant Krishna consciousness. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur writes it Anuvritti commentary that too much endeavor to acquire knowledge on the part of militant speculators or dry philosophers falls within the category of Atyahara, collecting more than needed. According to Srimad Bhagavatam, the endeavor of philosophical speculators to write volumes of books on dry philosophy devoid of Krishna consciousness is entirely futile. The work of karmis who write volumes of books on economic development also falls within the category of Atyahara. Similarly, those who have no desire for Krishna consciousness and who are simply interested in possessing more and more material things, either in the shape of scientific knowledge or monetary gain, are all included under the control of Atyahara. Karmis labor to accumulate more and more money for future generations only because they do not know their future position. Interested only in getting more and more money for their sons and grandsons, such foolish persons do not even know what their position is going to be in the next life. There are many incidents that illustrate this point. Once a great karmi accumulated a vast fortune for his sons and grandsons, but later, according to his karma, he took his birth in a cobbler's house located near the building which in his previous life he had constructed for his children. It so happened that when this very cobbler came to his former house, his former sons and grandsons beat him with shoes. Unless the karmis and nannies become interested in Krishna consciousness, they will simply continue to waste their life in fruitless activities. Accepting some of the scriptural rules and regulations for immediate benefit, as utilitarian advocate is called Niyamagraham, and neglecting the rules and regulations of the Shastras which are meant for spiritual development is called Niyama Agraham. The word Agraha means eagerness to accept, and Agraha means failure to accept. By the addition of either of these two words to the word Niyama, rules and regulations, the word Niyamagraha is formed. Thus, Niyamagraha has a twofold meaning that is understood according to the particular combination of words. Those interested in Krishna consciousness should not be eager to accept rules and regulations for economic advancement, yet they should very faithfully accept scriptural rules and regulations for the advancement of Krishna consciousness. They should strictly follow the regulative principles by avoiding illicit sex, meeting, gambling and intoxication. One should also avoid association with Mayamadis who simply blaspheme Vaishnava's devotees, Bhukti Kamis who are interested in material happiness, Mukti Kamis who desire liberation by merging into the existence of the formless, absolute Brahman, and Siddhi Kamis who desire the perfection of mystic yoga practice are classified as Atyaharis. To associate with such persons is not at all desirable. Desires to expand the mind by perfecting mystic yoga, merging into the existence of Brahman or attaining whimsical material prosperity are all included within the category of greed, laulya. All attempts to acquire such material benefits or so-called spiritual advancements are impediments on the path of Krishna consciousness. Modern warfare waged between capitalists and communists is due to their avoiding the advice of Srila Rupa Goswami regarding Atyahara. Modern capitalists accumulate more wealth than necessary, and the communists, envious of their prosperity, want to nationalize all wealth and property. Unfortunately, the communists do not know how to solve the problem of wealth and its distribution. Consequently, when the wealth of the capitalist falls into the hands of communists, no solution results. Opposed to these two philosophies, the Krishna conscious ideology states that all wealth belongs to Krishna. Thus, unless all wealth comes under the administration of Krishna, there can be no solution to the economic problem of mankind. Nothing can be solved by placing wealth in the hands of the communists or the capitalists. If a $100 bill is lying on the street, someone may pick it up and put it in his pocket. Such a man is not honest. Another man may see the money and decide to let it remain there, thinking that he should not touch another's property. Although the second man does not steal the money for his own purposes, he is unaware of its proper use. The third man who sees the $100 bill may pick it up, find a man who lost it and deliver it to him. This man does not steal the money to spend for himself, nor does he neglect it and let it lie in the street. By taking and delivering it to the man who has lost it, this man is both honest and wise. Simply transferring wealth from capitalists to communists cannot solve the problem of modern politics. For it has been demonstrated that when a communist gets money, he uses it for his own sense gratification. The wealth of the world actually belongs to Krishna, and every living entity, man and animal, has the birthright to use God's property for his maintenance. When one takes more than his maintenance requires, be he a capitalist or a communist, he is a thief, and as such is liable to be punished by the laws of nature. The wealth of the world should be used for the welfare of all living entities, for that is the plan of Mother Nature. Everyone has the right to live by utilizing the wealth of the Lord. When people learn the art of scientifically utilizing the Lord's property, they will no longer encroach upon one another's right. Then an ideal society can be formed. The basic principle of such a spiritual society is stated in the first mantra of Sri Ishopanishad: Ishavasyam idam sarvam yatkincha jagatyam jagat tena tektena bhunjita magridakasya svidhanam. Everything animate or inanimate that is within the universe is controlled and owned by the Lord. One should therefore accept only those things necessary for himself, which are set aside as his quota, and should not accept other things, knowing well to whom they belong. Krishna conscious devotees know very well that this material world is designed by the complete arrangement of the Lord to fulfill all the necessities of life for all living beings without their having to encroach upon the life or rights of one another. This complete arrangement affords a proper quota of wealth for everyone according to his real needs, and thus everyone may live peacefully according to the principle of plain living and high thinking. Unfortunately, materialists who have neither faith in the plan of God nor any aspiration for higher spiritual advancement misuse their God-given intelligence only to augment their material possessions. They devise many systems such as capitalism and materialistic communism to advance their material position. They are not interested in the laws of God or in a higher goal, always anxious to fulfill their unlimited desires for sense gratification. They are conspicuous by their ability to exploit their fellow living beings. When human society gives up these elementary faults enumerated by Srila Rupa Goswami, Atyahar, etc., all enmity will cease between men and animals, capitalists and communists, and so forth. In addition, all problems of economic or political maladjustment and instability will be solved. This pure consciousness is awakened by the proper spiritual education and practice offered scientifically by the Krishna consciousness movement. This Krishna consciousness movement offers a spiritual community that can bring about a peaceful condition in the world. Every intelligent man should purify his consciousness and rid himself of the above mentioned six entrances to devotional service by taking wholehearted shelter of this Krishna consciousness movement. So let us revise. Atyahara prayasascha prajalpo niyamagraham janasangascha laulyamcha shadbir bhaktir vinashyati. One's devotional service is spoiled when he becomes too entangled in the following six activities. 1. Eating more than necessary or collecting more funds than required. 2. Over-endeavoring for mundane things that are very difficult to obtain. 3. Talking unnecessarily about mundane subject matters. 4. Practicing the scriptural rules and regulations only for the sake of following them and not for the sake of spiritual advancement. Or rejecting the rules and regulations of the scriptures and working independently or whimsically. 5. Associating with worldly minded persons who are not interested in Krishna consciousness. And 6. Being greedy for mundane achievements. Atyahara prayasascha prajalpo niyamagraha janasangascha laulyamcha shadbir bhaktir vinashyati. Hare Krishna. We'll continue further tomorrow.